We're very excited to have Professor Julie Sook here with us. She's a professor at the Fordham University School of Law, just across the street. She's the author of the books We the Women, The Unstoppable Mothers of the Equal Rights Amendment, and After Misogyny, How the Law Fails Women and What to Do About It, which is forthcoming next month, and dozens of law review articles and book chapters on comparative constitutional law, equality, and anti-discrimination law, procedure and processes of legal change, and gender. She's a graduate of Harvard College and Yale Law School, where she held a Paul and Daisy Soros Fellowship for New Americans and received her Doctor of Philosophy in Politics at Oxford, where she was a Marshall Scholar. We're very excited to have Julie Sook here with us, and I'm pleased to welcome her to today's platform.
Well, thank you so much. I'm absolutely thrilled to be here today to talk about a century of founding mothers, global feminism, and the U.S. Constitution. And I do want to begin by thanking the Ethical Culture Society for inviting me. The Ethical Culture Society's founding father, Felix Adler, founded this organization and helped found many others in his life on the philosophy of deed, not creed. And although I've never personally, until perhaps now, been a member of the Ethical Culture Society, this philosophy perfectly describes the approach that I have come to take to the U.S. Constitution, deed, not creed. Like Felix Adler, I immigrated to the United States as a child, in my case from South Korea. I became American by pledging allegiance to the flag every day in my public school in Queens and learning to love the U.S. Constitution, which I grew up believing to be the best constitution in the world, written by brilliant founding fathers who were demigods worthy of eternal veneration. But as a legal scholar, I found myself drifting away from this creed as I learned more about constitutions, modern constitutions around the globe, which led me to question whether the U.S. Constitution, particularly as it's interpreted and enforced by a very powerful Supreme Court, was itself drifting away from the needs of a modern democracy in which women and people of color could live and participate as fully equal citizens, even though the founding fathers did not consider them to be worthy of that. Has America's Constitution and the civic culture around it become a creed that prevents the deeds necessary for our law and politics to meet the changing needs and mores of all Americans in the 21st century? So, demigods or not, the founding fathers of the U.S. Constitution knew that neither they nor the Constitution they adopted were perfect, that the process of making a more perfect union would have to continue. James Madison, for instance, wrote that useful alterations will be suggested by experience could not but be foreseen. And that was how he explained why the Constitution included a rule for amendments set out at Article 5 of the Constitution. The goal of that rule was to make it possible, but not too easy and not too difficult, to change the Constitution as the sentiments and needs of the people changed. Madison warned that an extremely difficult amendment process might perpetuate the discovered faults of the Constitution. One of the faults that Americans discovered about the Constitution was that its provisions guaranteeing liberty and equality did not protect all persons. Black people were not assumed to be legal persons or citizens until the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments were adopted after the Civil War. And women were not accorded equal rights, even under those post-Civil War amendments, and therefore many states continued to deny women the right to vote until the 19th Amendment was ratified in 1920. These amendments were pursued under Article 5 of the Constitution, which provides that Congress proposes amendments by two-thirds vote in both houses, and then the amendment can be ratified by three-fourths of the states, either by their legislatures or by ratifying conventions in those states, with Congress to determine the mode of ratification. And it's important to note that the original faults of the 1787 Constitution, which permitted slavery and counted enslaved persons as 3/5 of a person and permitted women to be excluded from most of the rights of legal personhood, including the vote, were perpetuated for a pretty long time before the Article 5 amendment process actually worked to correct them. So even though at the founding there were abolitionists who wanted slavery to be outlawed from the Constitution at the beginning, the amendments outlawing slavery didn't get passed until 8 decades after. And even though the Women's Rights Convention at Seneca Falls in 1848 demanded women's suffrage, our Constitution did not outlaw the denial of the vote on account of sex until 1920, again, about 8 decades after that. Regardless of what the Founding Fathers intended, and regardless of how it worked in the 18th century, when America had far fewer states, far fewer people on far smaller land, Article 5 does make it extremely difficult, and even when successful, extremely slow to change the Constitution, especially when the fault being corrected by amendment is the exclusion of some people who are deemed inferior and unworthy of citizenship. This fact about Article 5 is very important to understanding why women are still fighting for an equal rights amendment after 100 years without it being formally recognized as part of the Constitution today. In 1923, nearly 100 years ago, suffragists Alice Paul and Crystal Eastman wrote an amendment to the Constitution that would guarantee equality of all legal rights to women beyond the right to vote, and persuaded some congressmen to initiate the Article 5 amendment process on that proposal. The history of women's efforts at changing the Constitution and correcting its faults, a history of partial successes and partial failures, reveal some profound and troubling facts about the prospects for constitutional democracy in the United States moving forward. The study of global feminism as a driver of constitutional change in many of our peer democracies around the world brings sharper focus to the observations that I will share with you about this today. So, although women introduced it in 1923, Congress actually didn't adopt the Equal Rights Amendment until 1972. That is, getting 2/3 of both the House and the Senate to adopt the ERA took nearly half a century. And just as a reminder, this is what the amendment says. Section 1, equality of rights under the law shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of sex. Section 2, Congress shall have the power to enforce by appropriate legislation the provisions of this article. And Section 3, this amendment shall take effect 2 years after the date of ratification. In 1972, well over 90% of the members of Congress voted for it. But in an effort to calm a very powerful opponent who was known for filibustering civil rights laws, the ERA supporters agreed to a 7-year deadline in the resolution introducing the Equal Rights Amendment. That paragraph reads from the resolution, resolved by the Senate and House of Representatives of the United States of America and Congress assembled, 2/3 of each house concurring therein, that the following article is proposed as an amendment to the Constitution of the United States, which shall be valid to all intents and purposes as part of the Constitution when ratified by the legislatures of 3/4 of the several states within 7 years from the date of its submission by Congress. So what happened? After Congress adopts it, 35 states ratified the ERA pretty quickly and within the first 5 years, which 3 states short of the 38 necessary to get 3/4 of 50 states. Ratification stalled in part because Phyllis Schlafly led a very active Stop ERA campaign in some of the battleground states, including Illinois. Congress voted to extend the time frame on ratification by another 3 years, but no additional states ratified the ERA before 1982, when it was presumed dead and no longer viable. But then in 2017, Nevada's legislature ratified the ERA, and then Illinois ratified it in 2018, and Virginia in 2020. So that brings us up to 38. But meanwhile, and this was in the 70s, five states that had ratified the ERA took actions claiming to rescind or take back their ratifications. So today we ask, is the ERA part of the Constitution? And there's been some litigation. Two of the states that ratified late have persisted in litigation asking a court to order the archivist of the United States to just add the ERA to the Constitution, since it has technically been adopted by two-thirds of both houses of Congress and ratified by three-fourths of the states, with Article 5 of the Constitution saying nothing about deadlines and requiring just those two things. And on the other side, skeptics raise the very reasonable question about what to do about those three late ratifications. They come nearly 40 years after the ratification deadline, and meanwhile, five states have rescinded since the 1970s. How could that bring the ratification count up to 38? So this is a very active and live issue in our politics. This past Tuesday, the Senate Judiciary Committee held a hearing on these difficult issues, and I encourage you to watch the hearing on the Senate Judiciary Committee's website. There's a proposed resolution right now that would recognize the ERA as ratified and part of the Constitution, essentially removing the deadline, excusing some states for ratifying very late, and rejecting the efforts by other states to rescind their ratifications. In the last two sessions of Congress before this one, it's voted to remove the deadline on ERA ratification, but the Senate did not follow. And the question now is, if in this Congress or future Congresses, if both houses were to take action to remove the deadline, could that make the ERA part of the Constitution? Could Congress legally do this? And more importantly, if Congress can do it legally, should it take this action? So I want to say a little bit about the legal questions involved. Whether or not it's legal for Congress to remove the deadline now depends on what kind of deadline we all think it is. Was it an expiration date for the proposed amendment, or a due date or target date that could be changed if circumstances warrant? And I'd invite you to just think about deadlines. The ordinary deadlines that govern people's lives, if you think about the deadlines that you face for work projects, student papers, return of library books, these are due dates. If the task is completed after the due date, it may or may not be accepted late. But the point is that it depends, and it is often the case, thankfully for me, and I'm sure for many other people in the room, it's often the case that being late on a deadline is excused at the discretion of the party who issued it. But it's also true that sometimes the deadline is clearly an expiration date, after which late work cannot be accepted or counted. The Constitution's provisions on amendment say nothing about this, say nothing about ratification deadlines. So what does that mean for the deadlines Congress imposed on almost every amendment since the Prohibition Amendment? Expiration date or target date? If it's a target date, Congress can change it. Congress changed it once in 1978. Congress can excuse extreme lateness, depending on what the reasons are. So what Article 5 of the Constitution does say is that Congress is in charge of proposing amendments that it deems necessary. It also empowers Congress to choose the mode of ratification, whether they're going to ask state legislatures to ratify the amendment or state ratifying conventions to ratify it. And that power to deciding the mode of ratification, which belongs to Congress, that's been widely accepted, even by the Supreme Court, as including the power to put deadlines in on state legislatures or conventions when they're ratifying any amendment that Congress proposes. But because that deadline power belongs to Congress, so too does the power to change any deadlines that Congress imposes. Here, I think we can take a step back and really think about why we have an amendment process in the first place. It's designed to give the people's representatives in Congress the leading role in shaping constitutional meaning, especially at moments when the unelected Supreme Court's interpretations of the Constitution might neglect the modern needs and sentiments of the American people. The history of the ERA's making by women, I would call them our founding mothers, should matter to how Congress decides to use this important power and responsibility. The House and Senate voted by well over two-thirds to adopt the ERA in 1971 and 1972. Those votes weren't even close because there was extraordinary bipartisan effort by women in Congress. While the 90-plus percent vote in support of the ERA at that time makes it look easy to us, and perhaps should have been easy, it wasn't easy at all, actually, for Martha Griffiths, the chief sponsor of the ERA in the House, to get the House to even consider debate and vote on the ERA. She had to overcome some rules in Congress that are not amenable to debate and consideration of every proposal that might have a lot of popular support. We have rules in Congress that are not necessarily democratic. The ERA did not even get a debate or a vote in the House throughout the 1960s, even though the Senate adopted it twice in the 1950s, because the chairman of the House Judiciary Committee at the time opposed the ERA and didn't want the whole body of the House to debate about it. Martha Griffiths had to do something kind of out of the ordinary. She had to get more than half of the members of the House to sign a discharge petition to wrest control over the ERA's fate out of that man's hands. And once she got it to the floor, almost everyone there voted for it. That House included the first women of color elected to Congress, Patsy Takemoto Mink, the first Asian American woman in the House, and Shirley Chisholm, the first black woman in Congress. They were fierce advocates for the ERA, and they were joined by Republican women who focused on the disadvantages women faced because they were mothers, including Congresswomen Margaret Heckler and Florence Dwyer. Most importantly, Congress adopted the ERA to make sex equality a fundamental constitutional principle because at the time, the Supreme Court, consisting of 9 men, was very reluctant to recognize sex equality as a principle protected by the 14th Amendment. This began to change once the ERA was adopted by Congress. Some of our most important constitutional amendments, some that succeeded in changing the words of the Constitution and some that did not, came in direct response to decisions of the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court's decision in Dred Scott, ruling that black people could never be US citizens, made it necessary for Congress to propose the 13th and 14th Amendments, which were drafted by abolitionists, including women in the abolitionist movement. Two states rescinded their ratifications of the 14th Amendment, which Congress ignored when it recognized the 14th Amendment as part of the Constitution. And then, after the Supreme Court struck down federal laws that restricted child labor, Congress proposed the Child Labor Amendment in 1924 to authorize federal legislation regulating and prohibiting, in some circumstances, child labor. The Ethical Culture Society has a presence in that history because one of the other organizations co-founded and chaired for some years by your founder, Felix Adler, was the National Child Labor Committee, which led efforts to get Congress to propose a child labor amendment at the time. After 28 states ratified the child labor amendment, the Supreme Court dramatically changed its approach to child labor. Not only did the court begin to uphold federal child labor laws as well as other labor regulations, it also conceded that the question of a constitutional amendment's timeliness was a political question that the Constitution left to Congress rather than to the courts. So in a very important and much discussed case in the context of the ERA today, Coleman versus Miller, decided in 1939, the Supreme Court held that Congress, because Congress is closest to the sentiments of the people, should assess the social, economic, and political conditions after the Child Labor Amendment has been ratified to decide whether it is still necessary and therefore still timely. And that's exactly what the current Senate resolution to remove the ERA deadline is attempting to do. So if we are going to be nitpicky as lawyers, it is true that the Child Labor Amendment had no ratification deadline, whereas the ERA does. But if we are going to be nitpicky lawyers, we should also pick equally at very important difference in language and form between the ERA's deadline and the expiration date deadlines that Congress put on other amendment proposals throughout the 20th century. The Prohibition Amendment, for instance, included a section that said, in no uncertain terms, this article shall be inoperative unless it shall have been ratified as an amendment to the Constitution by the legislatures of the several states as provided in the Constitution within 7 years from the date of the submission hereof to the states by the Congress. So the inoperative unless language gets repeated in the 20th, 21st, and 22nd amendments, and it gets put in the language of the amendment, proposed amendment itself, not in the resolution just proposing the amendment. And so this stands in stark contrast to the ERA deadline's more flexible language, which they put in the resolution, not in the text of the amendment. And it stipulates that the ERA will be valid when ratified within 7 years. So we know for sure if it comes back in 7 years, it's definitely part of the Constitution. If it comes back after 7 years, has it expired? Who knows? Like, there's no answer to that question. I read that as Congress saying, we'll come back to that when the situation arises. And the situation has now arisen, arguably, because of the 38 ratifications, including the late ratifications. So here, if you look at when ratified within 7 years, valid when ratified, contrast that with inoperative unless ratified within 7 years, I think you see a clear difference between an expiration date deadline and a target date, like when you have your library books due deadline. And the target date is something that can be changed at the discretion of the issuer, as opposed to an expiration date, which clearly expresses the intent to expire and extinguish the proposal at that time. And of course, now having established that it's legal for Congress to change or remove the deadline, that doesn't answer the question of whether Congress should. But I want to point out that the next question, should Congress do this, it's not for the lawyers. It's for the people. It's a political question. And commenting on the ERA, the late Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg said in 1978 that an informed judgment cannot be made by crystal ball, but only by focusing on the precise situation existing when the ratification process is completed. So we need to consider the precise situation that exists today when the ERA ratification process has been completed. Skeptics will say that the ERA is no longer needed because Supreme Court decisions have enforced sex equality under the 14th Amendment's Equal Protection Clause. Nonetheless, in all three states that ratified the ERA in the 21st century after 2017, the ratification efforts were led by women, including Black women rising stars in the state legislatures who worked across partisan lines to achieve ratification. These included Pat Spearman, who is an ordained minister, former military officer, openly LGBT mom in Nevada, Juliana Stratton, a mother of four daughters and now Lieutenant Governor of Illinois, and Jennifer McClellan in Virginia, the first member of the Virginia House of Delegates to give birth while in office, and now, as of last Tuesday, the first Black woman elected to Congress from Virginia. And all of these women in the ratification debates of the 21st century emphasize the continuing need for law and public policy to address remaining gender inequalities. These continuing problems include pay inequity, often attributable to disadvantage women face because of pregnancy, motherhood, and caregiving obligations, as well as the persistence of sexual assault and harassment that the Me Too movement really brought out to the public. These problems, the disadvantages associated with childbearing and child rearing and sexual violence, took on a new sense of urgency for many American women after the Supreme Court stopped protecting the constitutional right to terminate a pregnancy just a few months ago in Dobbs versus Jackson Women's Health. That decision effectively exposes millions of American women to laws that force them to bear children, even those conceived through sexual assault, in states that do nothing to alleviate the burdens, disadvantages, and risks of mortality that stem from maternity. The Dobbs decision demonstrates the Supreme Court's pinched view of the 14th Amendment's commitments as limited to those widely accepted at the moment of the 14th Amendment's ratification in 1868. That was a moment before women could vote and before women were otherwise regarded by the legal order as equal citizens. It is precisely for moments like these that our constitutional amendment process entrusts Congress with the power to respond on behalf of the people. If Congress had not deployed its Article 5 power in 1868 to declare the 14th Amendment ratified, despite the fact that two states tried to rescind their ratifications, that foundation, equal protection of the laws, that foundation of inclusive democracy would never have become part of the U.S. Constitution. Through the resolution now recognizing that the continued vitality of the ERA makes it valid and makes the ratifications valid, Congress could express a commitment to modern ideas of gender equality where the Supreme Court has been stuck in the ideas of 1868. So finally, even if the ERA does not move this current sitting Supreme Court to change what it's going to do about women's rights issues, there's still another hugely important reason why the ERA should be added to the Constitution. It's really a fundamental principle that women have been fighting for a century within political structures that have made it unfairly difficult to achieve women's empowerment. The ERA did not get heard, did not even get a debate under ordinary procedures in the House due to the power system of the Judiciary Committee. So Martha Griffiths had to deploy the discharge petition, which revealed that almost everyone in the House was willing to vote for the ERA with no deadline in 1970. Yet, why do we end up with a deadline? Because a small handful of senators, led by Southern segregationists, essentially filibustered the ERA in 1970, with a couple of vocal men insisting on the deadline and other modifications to the amendment proposal, preventing a vote in the Senate before that session of Congress ended in 1970. That's why it had to come back in 71 and 72. So similar anti-democratic tactics enabled the idiosyncratic parliamentary rules to be deployed by men in state legislatures to avoid ratification of the ERA in Nevada, Illinois, and Virginia in the 1970s. Congress should examine the history of these states' late ratifications, which really only occurred after the next generation finally succeeded in getting more women, and especially more Black women, elected. All these things matter to the political decision as to whether the lateness of ratification should be excused by Congress. And I also want to note that women's uphill battle for the ERA has not been a total failure. While the ERA did fall three states short of full Article 5 ratification in the 70s, the Supreme Court did change its attitude toward sex equality cases during the time that the ERA was being ratified because the ERA was being ratified. Thanks to the brilliant advocacy of Ruth Bader Ginsburg, the Supreme Court made many rulings that struck down laws that discriminated against women, reading sex equality into the 14th Amendment. Assuming that those precedents stay with us, it's clear that women's advocacy for the constitutional amendment made important changes to constitutional law. Women changed the Constitution without amending it. Does that mean the ERA is no longer needed? So to say that seems to concede that women made a transformative change to our democracy with their hard work and persistence that you and I cannot see, and our children cannot see when we open up our copies of the pocket Constitution. The work that women have done as founding mothers of the Constitution remains invisible in the text of the Constitution. Their status as founding mothers is fuzzy, a very far cry away from the veneration that we reserve for James Madison and other 18th century men who owned slaves and adopted the 1787 Constitution. Completing the process of ERA ratification would enshrine the deeds of these women in our basic law, elevate their status to founding mothers, and perhaps lead the next generation of Americans to see beyond the blind veneration of the Constitution and the founding fathers. The history and present predicament of the ERA highlight a tragic reality that took hold because the ERA failed half a century ago. Americans have lost our ability to change the Constitution. The US Constitution has not been amended since 1992. That amendment, limiting congressional pay raises, was actually written and adopted by Congress in 1789. It was actually written by James Madison, and it took 203 years to ratify. But before that, the last amendment that was ratified by a healthy supermajority of the states was the ERA, just not enough states to add it to the Constitution then. And after the ERA was presumed dead, after the second deadline in 1982, Congress did not send any further amendment proposals to the states for ratification. So since the ERA's rise and fall, the Article 5 amendment process itself also appears to be dead. By contrast, let's observe what's happening around the world. Since the 1990s, women have achieved constitutional amendments that have reinforced and further advanced gender equality in many democracies throughout the world. The late Justice Ginsburg often pointed out that nearly every constitution written after World War II has a basic guarantee of equal rights between women and men. Those ERAs date to the 1940s, and even with those provisions in place, some countries' constitutional courts issued decisions that limited the meaning of sex equality. They struck down government programs to increase the representation of women in politics and other fields where they were underrepresented. Feminists throughout the world fought for additional amendments to their constitutions that made clear that government could promote equal access by women and men to positions of political and economic responsibility. This happened in France, and in some cases, Felix Adler's original home country, Germany. In Germany, there was an amendment in the 1990s that obligated government to eradicate existing disadvantages that were on the basis of sex. These amendments have transformed the composition and workings of government and industry throughout the world, rapidly increasing the sheer numbers of women in legislatures and corporate boards, with many advanced wealthy democracies coming much closer today to achieving 50-50 gender parity than the United States has. Meanwhile, court decisions in the United States make it really difficult to pass laws that require gender parity or any kind of affirmative action to overcome women's disadvantages or underrepresentation in leadership. The Supreme Court is anticipated to issue a decision this year in the Harvard and UNC affirmative action cases challenging race-based affirmative action. and its decision is likely to have reverberations limiting what the government can do to address existing gender disadvantages. So if we look across the world, in Chile, women were at the forefront of a process to write a brand new constitution for the nation, which was one of the most ambitious constitutions ever written in terms of the protection of women's rights, including reproductive rights, indigenous rights, and environmental protection. While that constitution was not accepted by the Chilean electorate in the referendum in the fall, it shaped the nation's imagination and shifted everyone's baseline expectations about what a constitution can be. Now Chile is in a new process after that constitutional failure of rewriting the constitution, and the commitment to gender parity as a fundamental rule with regard to who they're going to elect to the new constitution-making body has stuck. In Ireland, an innovative process known as citizens' assemblies was utilized to assist Parliament in proposing the constitutional amendment in 2018, which the voters ratified in a referendum, significantly liberalizing Ireland's abortion law. Citizens' assemblies are randomly selected bodies of citizens from a cross-section of the population with geographic, gender, age, socioeconomic, and other forms of diversity informing that random selection process. Citizens' assemblies deliberated on constitutional amendments to redefine marriage to include same-sex couples, constitutional amendment that liberalized abortion, and now a proposed constitutional amendment guaranteeing sex equality like the ERA, and furthermore, an amendment proposal that would revamp existing provisions of the 1937 Irish Constitution to recognize the value of care by people of all genders within and outside the home. The citizens' assemblies are not mentioned in the Irish Constitution's provisions on constitutional amendment. The rule in Ireland is that Parliament proposes and the voters decide in a referendum on constitutional amendments. But Parliament innovated. It created citizens' assemblies to make the constitutional amendment process more democratic and more transparent. It used the amendment power that the Constitution gives it in a way that enabled the body to find out where the people stood after deliberations to achieve compromise on some of the most sensitive issues facing the nation. And I think the Irish example is a very important reminder that just as Congress invented ratification deadlines in the exercise of its amendment power in the 20th century, they'd never used deadlines before that, Congress can be innovative differently in the future. It can invent other mechanisms like citizens' assemblies that are not mentioned in Article 5, but not prohibited by it either, to facilitate the management of the amendment process in ways that incorporate the views and will of the people. So that's where I'd like to end, by coming back home to the United States. Must the Constitution be a creed rather than a set of deeds? Can we the people change the Constitution? Perhaps we need to begin by being more proactive about the process by which we change the Constitution. Article 5 does not mention deadlines, but Congress invented them, and Congress is authorized by the Constitution to manage the ratification process. How might Congress innovate again in a way that protects the role of the people in a democracy in shaping the modern meaning of the Constitution? The amendment process has come to feel remote and out of reach to most Americans in the generation since the ERA's failure, but it is such an important channel for constitutional modernization. So whether it leads to the ERA finally taking its rightful place in the Constitution, or to other necessary updates to our 18th century document, the amendment process is the only thing, really, that enables the people, through their elected representatives, to challenge the constitutional direction taken by the Supreme Court. Now, more than ever, there's a need to reactivate the amendment process to protect the American people's most fundamental constitutional commitments. Sex equality, that's the ERA, and more importantly, the possibility of making that more perfect union through Congress's prudent management of the Article 5 process are the things we need in order to keep our democracy alive. So thank you very much, and I'd be happy to take your questions. I know that's a lot.
Thank you for that. Pardon me. Thank you for that very cogent and illustrative talk. My question is not only about our ideals, but as you have pointed out, what's going to happen on the street, and maybe if not on the street, in the courthouse. That's deed. We have a Supreme Court right now, which is, it seems to me, subject or ought to be subject to, pardon the expression, strict scrutiny, or at least careful watching. In India, in 2022, an amendment was passed, I think it was number 14, that guaranteed equality on the basis of not just sex, but also caste. It seems to have had made no real difference in terms of actual, shall we say, progress in the direction that you've mentioned. And I'm not suggesting any opposition to an equal rights amendment passing. But what sorts of other concerns might you have, particularly given the situation, you mentioned Dobbs, for example, in passing, that the Supreme Court will find a way of wiggling through even if the ERA is passed?
Right, so this is an excellent question, and I thank you for it. If the ERA gets added to the Constitution, the established method that has developed in the United States over time, by which we seek constitutional change, in my view, unfortunately, has been through the courts. In a lot of healthy democracies, when the courts make decisions that interpret equality in some way that's contestable, when the people disagree, they amend the Constitution. In the United States, because Article 5 makes it so hard to amend the Constitution, very often people who disagree with the Supreme Court's rulings bring litigation and ask the Supreme Court to overrule or change or distinguish or make new law. And so that's how we've been conditioned to accept the process of constitutional change in this country. Some of my colleagues call it juristocracy because only judges get to change the Constitution. And in a democracy, when you compare us to many other countries, that does not seem to be the best way, particularly when the Supreme Court, you might end up at certain historical moments with the Supreme Court that's extremely out of touch with the people. So if we get the ERA, I don't have any reason to believe that the current sitting Supreme Court is going to radically change its attitude towards cases involving women's rights or equality. Although, arguably, they would have to by their own understanding of their constitutional methodology, because they could no longer at least say these rights were not protected under the 14th Amendment because the meaning of the 14th Amendment was fixed at 1868. The meaning of the ERA actually adopted in 1972, when sex equality means something totally different than what it might have meant in 1868, 100 years earlier, then a ratification window that lasts from 1972 until 2020, including all those meanings that the women in the state legislatures in Nevada, Illinois, and Virginia pointed to, right? Those things are part of the public meaning of the words equality of rights that are in the ERA. And so by their own methodology, the court would actually have to consider those modern meanings in enforcing the Equal Rights Amendment. But still, some people do not really expect this court to be principled and consistent with their own methodology. I get that. But here I want to also point to resuscitating the amendment is not just about handing something over to the court. It's also about trying to reimagine what it means for Congress to interpret the Constitution, for the people themselves to interpret the Constitution and to act through their elected representatives. Even when the ERA was adopted, the women in Congress who were in favor of it, they did not think that the nine guys on the Supreme Court were going to radically change what they did. But instead, and this is why I even bothered to read and include Section 3 of the ERA, which looks completely meaningless. Section 3 of the ERA says that the ERA shall take effect within 2 years after the date of ratification. Look in your pocket constitutions. You'll notice that that doesn't really show up all that often. It shows up with the Prohibition Amendment. And it shows up with the Prohibition Amendment because it was a different understanding. It wasn't just, we're writing an amendment that we're going to hand over to the Supreme Court to enforce. It was more, we're writing an amendment where Congress and the state legislatures are going to take the leading role in enforcing this amendment by writing legislation in order to get rid of all the laws that discriminate, all the laws that disadvantage. And so the whole the idea that you're going to wait 2 years before the amendment goes into effect, it's really, if you're expecting some really radical changes, you're not going to get those changes from the court. You're going to get it from the legislature understanding that its job is to improve the equal pay laws, for example, improve the protections for gender violence, against gender violence. Here we're looking at a complete reimagining of what it even means to have constitutional rights, that they're not rights that you're going to depend on the Supreme Court to enforce, but that the legislature, listening to the people, will take a much more proactive role in building out an infrastructure that makes equality real.
I just want to extend my appreciation for this incredible presentation. It was wonderful. Given our representation in Congress does not truly represent the population of women, and also there's not enough women in Congress, who really gets to finalize the interpretation of law? Because it seems like it's a bouncing ball that goes from the Congress to the courts to judicial review, et cetera. And where's the people come in, really? I mean, you know, this is, and then that's where the public is just not understanding where our power is. Thank you. And how would you address that?
Absolutely. So you're asking a pretty deep question about how democratic our constitutional institutions really are, and I think that reawakening our habits and muscle memory around amending the Constitution should lead the American people to ask precisely that question. Specifically, that we talk a lot about the Senate filibuster, but even before the Senate filibuster, we had the Senate, which equally represents every state in the United States. It equally represents Wyoming and California, even though California has 70 times the population of Wyoming. And the Senate has the power to stop legislation passed by the House. The House is apportioned, but right now we're facing a lot of dynamics that are before the Supreme Court, leading to partisan gerrymandering with regard to congressional seats. Because the Supreme Court has been allowing the partisan gerrymandering, it may mean that many of the congressional seats, as well as the gerrymandering going on in state legislatures, may not necessarily represent ordinary people and their preferences. But these are all things that, you know, I forgot to mention this because maybe it's kind of depressing. You can't really change the equal representation of the states in the Senate even by using Article 5. The one thing that Article 5 says requires a different rule. The equal representation of the states in the Senate, the equal suffrage of the states in the Senate, cannot be subject to any amendment unless every state whose representation would be changed consents. So it's essentially a unanimity rule, not even the two-thirds, three-fourths, which is hard enough as it is. I should point out that the German Constitution makes unamendable human dignity, right? That's the thing you can never change using the amendment rule. Our Constitution made two things unamendable: the equal representation of the states in the Senate and the slave trade until 1808, right? That, if you look, read Article 5, you'll see that there. But of course, what that means, given these dynamics, is that we have a structure in the Constitution which is not as representative of the people of the nation as you might design it to be if you were starting over and trying to really make sure that everyone's voices were heard today. So I do think that what's at stake with the ERA is actually far greater and deeper than the ERA. Because it really raises the question, looking at the history of the ERA, we couldn't get something that most other countries consider equality between women and men as pretty basic, like free speech, freedom of religion, all of those things as pretty basic to a constitution that you need to have a legitimate democracy. We've struggled to get that into the constitution. And so if we actually grapple with that and try to change that, I think it's going to start raising questions about the amendment rule itself being something that entrenches non-democracy in the United States. And then I think young people, future generations, have to have a conversation about whether Article 5 is actually a good amendment rule, given the inclusive democracy that we, I think, are all trying to achieve in this country. So I do think that the ERA is a tip of a much larger iceberg, and we have a choice now whether we just treat it as a tragedy that we accept or a jumping off point for modernizing democracy.
We have one more. Is it you?
Or? Sure.
I agree with all the other people who have commented about this wonderful talk that you've given. I've learned so much. I really appreciate that. I have been worried, though, about the other side of not allowing the ratification process to go on and on, because there are forces out there who are starting the fetal personhood and probably will try to do an amendment then. And I can see the situation, I mean, it appears that the situation is we will just go on until we get the 38 states, and then it's in, and then there's all this problem getting it out. And so I can sort of see the problem with allowing it to go on and on, but how does something get defeated? And I don't want this to be defeated, but there are maybe other things that I do want defeated.
Absolutely. So this is the debate, and just coming back to James Madison, he said there are obvious dangers to making the amendment process too easy. And some of those dangers are real because of what we just talked about. Remember, Article 5 is also really different from the state constitutions, including the state constitution in New York, that gives the people a direct role in amending the constitution. In many states, the legislature adopts it in two consecutive legislative sessions, and then there's a referendum. In many states, you can also get an amendment on the ballot by ballot initiative. Whereas in the United States, really the relevant players are Congress and state legislatures. It's true that there's reference to state conventions. That's only been used once in our history. The typical amendment process is two-thirds of both houses of Congress. And if you think two-thirds of the Senate, which is not representative, and two-thirds of the House, which is increasingly gerrymandered, then that's, you know, you might say that the human life, and then three-fourths of the state legislatures, meaning 38, that means 12 states can veto an amendment, right? And so even though 38 is like a huge supermajority, and with the ERA, 38 includes some of the most populous states in, you know, California, New York, et cetera, But 12 states with that are far less populous can veto an amendment. And what that might mean is that our system that is baked into the Constitution will favor amendments that are brought forth by a minority of white supremacists and religious right folks over the more progressive women's rights, minority rights, or not minority rights, people of color rights, not necessarily a minority. So there is a real problem that you're right, that the process that we have may favor amendments like the Human Life Amendment. And so if we make the process easier by saying for the ERA purposes, we can reject the rescissions and allow late ratifications, we might be opening a Pandora's box to other constitutional changes. And this is why I do think it's really important that people are not single issue oriented with the ERA. I think it is really important to think about not only what the ERA says about women's rights and women's history, but what it says about democracy and other ways of thinking about Article 5. I mean, of course, this is a really difficult and I think scary question because it's, well, if we're going to unravel Article 5, then how are we actually, are we going to end up having to write a new constitution? And I don't think we should be terrified of that because that's exactly what the Founding Fathers did. They went to Philadelphia because they were going to amend the Articles of Confederation to fix some problems, but then they decided to write a whole new constitution, and then they subjected it to ratification by 9 out of 13 states rather than the unanimity rule that was would have been required to amend or replace the Articles of Confederation. So, and indeed in Chile, they've had a process by which a whole new constitution is being written. And that might seem scary because this is a very big country that's very divided right now. Note, if you started over, you wouldn't have to get 2/3 of both houses of Congress. You could write new procedural rules. You could have people elected not based on state population, but based on just at large who is in the United States. So you might end up finding out that the American people actually favor things that you favor more than the things that tend to be favored by the process that we currently have.